So last time we met Grendel, we heard about Herat and how he terrorized it for 12 years. King Hrothgar's got bad things going on with Grendel and Herat. Now we're gonna meet our epic hero. In chapter three, we're gonna have the coming of Beowulf. And so I'm gonna read through sort of Beowulf and how he starts his journey and that kind of a thing. So here we go. Chapter three, the coming of Beowulf. So the living sorrow of Halfdane's son simmered, bitter and fresh, and no wisdom or strength could break it. That agony hung on king and people alike, harsh and unending, violent and cruel and evil. Pause. All right, Halfdane's son. Who's Halfdane's son? Well, if you go back to the genealogy at the beginning, you discover that Halfdane is a king of Denmark, and he is Hrothgar's father. So Halfdane's son is Hrothgar. But this is actually an important moment to maybe help you culturally in understanding the story. It turns out that Vikings didn't have traditional last names like we have traditional last names. In fact, you would be known by your father. And so whoever your father was, your name would be, your name followed by whatever son. So my dad's name is Lauren, and my name, if I was a Viking, would be Scott Lorenson. And you can actually look at yours, and if again, if you're a woman, daughter would be at the end of that instead of son. So if I had a sister and her name was Sarah, she'd be Sarah Lauren's daughter. And that's how the names go. What's interesting about it is you actually get some good knowledge about characters through their names. The names like Beowulf, Beowulf's name is indicative of who he is, but also how your name is the same or different from your father says something about you in old Viking stories. If your name started with the same letter as your father's name, it's an alliteration, and that's pretty typical. That was normal. It's an indication that generally you're just a regular guy. And Halfdane, he had a son named Hrothgar. This guy starts with the same letter. He's a normal guy. He's not an epic hero. If you recall, Scyld was the first king, and he had a son named Beo. Beo sounds nothing like Scyld. Scyld means shield, and he had a son Beo named Bear. And then Beo had a son named Halfdane. Right, and so each one of these characters is sort of an epic hero, but Hrothgar is not. He is just a regular guy who's named in a traditional way, and whatever. But you can figure out what your Viking name is and post it, in the comments. Your name, your dad's name, first name. By the way, this is a. I know I'm talking a long time about something, and I know I'm gonna get back to the story. Just bear with me. This is why we have so many names like this, though, in our culture. There's so many Viking influences in our culture that there's a lot of last names that when they were written down, they had been like oral tradition names where you just change your last name based on your dad, and so you're always associated with your dad's behaviors. Like if your dad's a great guy, that's great for you. If your dad was Michael Jordan and or your dad's Tom Brady or your dad's LeBron James, you could be Scott LeBronson and everybody's like, "Oh, LeBron, I love that guy." But like if your dad's Jeffrey Dahmer, then you walk around with that stigma following you your entire life. So, I mean, like there's positives and negatives to that. But when the names got written down, they became permanent. Kind of like oral tradition stories, when they got written down, they became permanent. And so that's why we have so many last names with son on them. Jackson and like Michael Jackson or Johnson or Nelson. There's son names everywhere, and those go back to Viking heritage. So if you end up having a son on the end of your name, there's probably like Viking heritage somewhere back down the line, and the name got turned into your permanent name when it was written down for the first time. Which I think is cool. Anyway, back to our story. So the living sorrow of Halfdane's son simmered bitter and fresh, and no wisdom or strength could break it. That agony hung on king and people alike, harsh and unending, violent and cruel and evil. In his far-off home, Beowulf, Hygelac's follower, and the strongest of the Geats, greater and stronger than anyone anywhere in this world. Hold up. Beowulf is greater and stronger than anyone anywhere in this world. The narrator has told you that. It's fact. So he is an intense guy. Heard how Grendel filled knights with horror and quickly commanded a boat fitted out, proclaiming that he'd go to that famous king, would sail across the sea to Hrothgar now when help was needed. of the wise ones regretted his going, much as he was loved by the Geats. The omens were good, and they urged the adventure on. Pause again. Wait a second. This is weird. The omens were good? Isn't that like a pagan practice where they like cut up animals and looked at their entrails and like, you know, guessed based on them or dropped bones or something, like how things were going to go? Isn't this a pagan practice that's captured down in this Christian story? And you know, Beowulf's going to be a Christian, and why are they taking omens? You know, again, more evidence that maybe this story was originally a pagan story that was just translated into a Christian story by the author when he wrote it down. Let's see. The omens were good and they urged the adventure on. So Beowulf chose the mightiest men he could find, the bravest and the best of the Geats, 14 in all, and led them down to their boat. He knew the sea would point the prow straight to that distant Danish shore. So he's getting on a boat. The quest is starting. And he's got his 14 strongest guys, the best and greatest warriors in all of Geatland. It would be like if we picked the 14 greatest guys at BDHS, the strongest and the biggest and the most athletic, and we put them all in a boat, and their leader was like Arnold Schwarzenegger, you know, 6'8" and muscular as crap. That's what's going on here. And in fact, I feel like this is an epic moment. Hold on, we'll make this epic. You know, a moment like this needs background music. That's absolutely epic. Then they sailed, set their ship out on the waves, under the cliffs. Ready for what came, they wound through the currents, the seas beating at the sand, and were borne in the lap of their shining ship, lined with gleaming armor, going safely in that oak-hard boat to where their hearts took them. The wind hurried them over the waves. The ship foamed through the sea like a bird, until in the time they had known it would take, standing in the round curled prow, they could see sparkling hills high and green, jutting up over the shore. And rejoicing in those rock-steep cliffs, they quietly ended their voyage, jumping to the ground. The Geats pushed their boat to the sand and tied it like mail skirts and armor rattling as they swiftly boarded their ship. And then they gave thanks to God for the deep possible. You know, that epic moment in every story to introduce your hero and come off the quest, the soundtrack's playing. So they've traveled now from Geatland to Denmark, and they've landed on the Danish shore. One of the things that you see in a lot of heroic epics is a series of challenges for the epic hero. And we're going to have our first challenge for Beowulf here. There's a watchman, there's a coast guard, if you will, who stands on the cliff and rides a horse and has a spear. And his job is to keep dangerous people out of Denmark. So he's going to come down and encounter Beowulf. And we're going to watch this encounter. And I'll try and translate it for you so that you understand what's going on as a reader of Anglo-Saxon literature would. Let's see. Also, I think it's important they gave thanks to God for their easy crossing. Nothing really dangerous happened while they were sailing. High on a wall, a Danish watcher patrolling along the cliff saw the travelers crossing to the shore, their shields raised and shining. He came riding down, Hrothgar's lieutenant, spurring his horse, needing to know why they'd landed, these men in armor. Shaking his heavy spear in their faces, he spoke. So this guy comes riding down, and he shakes his spear in their faces, which is, you know, pretty insulting. He doesn't introduce them himself to them in a nice way. He just, you know, comes down, he's like, you know, like pointing a weapon at their faces. And this is what he has to say. Whose soldiers are you? You who've been carried in your deep-keeled ship across the sea road to this country of mine? Listen, I've stood here on these cliffs longer than you know, keeping our coast free of pirates, raiders sneaking ashore from their ships, seeking our lives and our gold. None has ever come so openly, and yet you've offered no password, no sign from my prince, no permission from my people for your landing here. Nor have I ever seen, out of all the men on earth, one greater than has come with you. No commoner carries such weapons unless his appearance and his beauty are both lies. You, tell me your name and your father's. No spies go further into Danish soil than you've come already. Strangers, from wherever it was you sailed, tell it, and tell it quickly. The quicker the better, I say, for us all. Speak, say exactly who you are and from where, and why? So this watcher comes down and he shakes a spear in Beowulf's face. Now, let's be honest, you know, Beowulf's like 6'8", so this guy's riding a horse. He's probably on eye level with Beowulf. But let's analyze what he says and how he says it, because it's important. He starts with a question: whose soldiers are you? You know, then he boasts about himself. You know, he's got to put a brag in there. I've stood on these cliffs longer than you know, keeping our coast free of pirates and raiders sneaking ashore. Is he calling them pirates? I think he is. Subtext: he's calling them pirates and raiders and sneaks. They're not sneaking. I mean, they just landed their ship and Beowulf got out there bold as brass and he's walking up the shore. You know, and he's accusing them of coming to steal their lives and their gold. Then, you know, he sort of revises. He says, none have ever come more openly. So Beowulf's not sneaking, even though he seemed to accuse him of sneaking. And yet you've offered no password, no sign from my prince or permission for your landing. So, like, he hasn't come with any kind of invitation. Beowulf was not invited to come. He just showed up. Then, for the first time, the guy acknowledges how big Beowulf is. You can almost get the sense that he's like, oh God. He says, nor have I ever seen out of all the men on earth one greater than has come with you. So he's like, oh my God, you're the biggest guy I've ever seen. Then he looks at Beowulf's equipment and he says, no commoner carries such weapons unless his appearance and his beauty are both lies. So it's almost like he's complimenting his weapons, but he's also calling him a liar at the same time. And here's the truth, like weapons and armor like Beowulf would be wearing or would have been wearing were enormously expensive. You know, a full suit of armor, it would cost as much as, you know, like a Lamborghini would today. So somebody walking around in a full suit of armor like Beowulf, it's almost the same as somebody driving around in a Lambo. You know, you look at them and you make assumptions. You either assume they're rich or you assume they're a drug dealer. You know, like either you know, for real, or there's something sketchy. And that's sort of what this guy's asking. He's like, are you a liar? Or are you really a prince? But that's insulting to Beowulf too. So finally he says, tell me your name and your father's. Well, that's what he should have said first. And actually he should have introduced himself first. If you're a good Viking, you say your name and your father's name. And then you ask the other people what their name and their father's names are. So he finally gets down to what he's supposed to have asked. So he's been sort of rude through this whole time. Tell me your name and your father's. No spies go further into Danish soil. So now he calls them spies. Then you've come already. Strangers from wherever it was you sailed, tell it and tell it quickly. The quicker, the better, I say for us all. Speak, say exactly who you are and from where and why. Like, he's asked this question three times now. Why is he asked the question three times? Well, the truth is that Beowulf doesn't answer him. And so, you know, have you ever been in a situation where like you're mad about something? And so like you go into the office and, you know, there's Miss Mintz and you're like, you know, Mr. Howard did this thing to me. And you expect her to like be on your side, but then she just doesn't say anything. She like looks at you and blinks. And so then you like change your rhetoric and tone it down a little bit. Well, yeah. And then, you know, still no response. So then you say it a third time. So Beowulf's just staring this guy down, right? Like he's like, tell me your name and your father's. And Beowulf just looks at him, like flexes a muscle or something. And then the guy is like, because each time it gets a little more polite. After calling them spies, then he revises it. Strangers from wherever it was you sailed, tell it and tell it quickly. And then he revises it again. Speak, say exactly who you are and from where and why. So I think he's clearly intimidated, and you get that if you read it and sort of analyze what's going on. Chapter 4. Their leader answered him, Beowulf, unlocking words from deep in his breast. We get a sense of Beowulf's voice here, like somewhere deep down in the depths of his breast. It's like a chest opens up and his voice comes out. We are Geats, men who follow Higelac. My father was a famous soldier, known far and wide as a leader of men. His name was Edgthoh. His life lasted many winters. Wise men all over the earth surely remember him still. And we have come seeking your prince, Halfdane's son, protector of this people, only in friendship. Instruct us, watchmen. Help us with your words. Our errand is a great one. Our business with the glorious king of the Danes, no secret. There's nothing dark or hidden in our coming. You know, if we've heard the truth and been told honestly, that your country is cursed with some strange, vicious creature that hunts only at night and that no one has seen. It is said, watchman, that he has slaughtered your people, brought terror to the darkness. Perhaps Hrothgar can hunt here, in my heart, for some way to drive this devil out. if anything will ever end the evils afflicting your wise and famous lord. Here he can cool his burning sorrow, or else he may see his suffering go on forever, for as long as Herat towers high on your hills. What did I just do? Okay, so Beowulf's response here seems very polite. The guy shook a spear at his face, and he could probably just kill this guy. But Beowulf is bound by rules and laws of sort of Anglo-Saxon hospitality. You can't go around killing people, and he's not going to solve this problem with his sword. So Beowulf, aside from being, physically intimidating and a great fighter, he's also a great thinker, and he's very socially adept, and we get that here. So let's go through this and look at the ways that he answers the watchman, but also the ways that he insults him in a reciprocal fashion. So he answers his question straight up. We are Geats, men who follow Higlak. My father was a famous soldier known far as wide as a leader of men. His name was Edgtho. So first off, Beowulf, his dad's name is Edgtho. Their names are nothing alike. This is an indication to you as an audience that he is superhuman, as if you didn't know that already. His life lasted many winters. Wise men all over the earth surely remember him still. So essentially he says, hey, my dad's name is Edgtho, my name's Beowulf. If you don't know my dad, you're an idiot. You're not wise. So, and we have come seeking your prince, Halfdane's son, protector of this people, only in friendship. So he's like, hey, we come in friendship. We're looking for Hrothgar. Instruct us, watchmen. Note that he calls him watchmen. Beowulf took notice that the watchman did not introduce himself like a polite person should, and so he's not going to ever ask this guy his name. You don't want to tell me your name? Fine, I'm going to call you by your job for the rest of the time I know you. I think that's interesting. So it would be like if you just started calling me teacher. Hey, teacher, if you saw Miss Mainz in the hallway, you're like, principal! It's almost insulting, but the guy started it, and Beowulf's just working with it. So instruct us, watchmen, help us with your words. Then he starts saying why he came. Very clearly, our errand is a great one. Our business with the glorious king of the Danes, no secret. Now, he's very polite to Hrothgar throughout here. Protector of the people, glorious king. There's nothing dark or hidden in our coming. Then he says, you know that your country's cursed with some strange, vicious creature that hunts only at night and that no one has seen. It said, watchmen, that he slaughtered your people, brought terror to the darkness. So this is a carefully crafted insult. This watchman brags about how tough he is and how he's kept Denmark safe. And Beowulf's like, if you're a watchman, why didn't you fight Grendel? Why aren't you doing your job? And so then he says, perhaps Hrothgar can hunt here in my heart for some way to drive this devil out. We got that language devil in there again, like the Christianity versus paganism. Beowulf's like, I've come to kill your monster. And, at this point, he says, I've come to kill your monster. And if you don't want me to, I'll leave. So he's like, I can either go kill your monster or I can get back in the boat. So to put this in sort of a modern context, imagine if this is, Brentsville High School, and there's some sort of hideous monster that lives in the furnace room, and it comes out and kills 30 people every now and again, just wipes out a classroom. And eventually nobody wants to come to Brentsville anymore because it's got this monster living in it. And then, one day, choppa, 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 in comes a helicopter and lands in the parking lot, and out jumps Arnold Schwarzenegger with like a rocket launcher and a machine gun. And he starts walking to the school. And then, of course, the school security guard's got to roll out. And he's like, you can't come in here with that rocket launcher and that, a machine gun. That's not okay. And of course, then Arnold Schwarzenegger's like, I hear you've got the monster. I'm here to kill it. Why haven't you done so? You're a security guard, right? And the guy's like, yeah, and then he's like, fine, you don't want me to go in the school, I'll get back in the chopper. And he turns around, he starts walking back to the chopper, and of course, what's a security guard going to say? He's going to say, come in and kill the monster, and that's essentially what happens. Beowulf makes this guy back down. He intimidates him, he insults him, he does it all politely, he does it all above board, so this guy can't possibly be upset by it. But he makes a victory out of this first encounter, and it's a bloodless victory. It's a socially acceptable victory. And I think as a reader, this is supposed to let you know that Beowulf is more than just muscles. There's things going on with him, and he's a master of society as well. Anyway, back to our story. The mounted officer answered him bluntly, the brave watchman. A soldier should know the difference between words and deeds, and keep that knowledge clear in his brain. I believe your words. I trust your friendship. Go forward, weapons and armor and all, on into Denmark. I'll guide you myself, and my men will guard your ship. Keep it safe here on our shores, your fresh tarred boat. Watch it well, until that curving prow carries across the sea to Geatland a chosen warrior who bravely does battle with the creature haunting our people, who survives that horror unhurt, and goes home bearing our love. So he changes his tune almost entirely. He's like, yeah, I'll take you to Hrothgar, and I'll even watch your ship for you while you're gone. Now, there is an implied threat here. He starts out with, a soldier should know the difference between words and deeds and keep the knowledge clear in his brain. So he's saying, like, you talk a big talk, Beowulf, but can you back it up? This is a big brag. Can you kill Grendel? I don't know. He's like, but I'm going to watch your ship for you, which also sounds nice. But he's like, but if you don't come back, that ship's mine, right? Like, I get to keep it. So, like, there is sort of like a double meaning here as well, but clearly Beowulf won this encounter. Then they moved on. Their boat lay moored tied tight to its anchor. Glittering at the top of their golden helmets, wild boar heads gleamed, shining decorations swinging as they marched, erect like guards, like sentinels, as though ready to fight. They marched, Beowulf and his men and their guide, until they could see the gables of Herat covered with hammered gold and glowing in the sun. That most famous of all dwellings, towering, majestic, its glittering roofs visible across the land. Their guide reined in his horse, pointing to the hall built by Hrothgar for the best and bravest of his men. The path was plain. They could see their way. Which brings us to chapter 6. You'll note that we skipped chapter 5. It's unimportant. But in chapter 5, the watchman's like, there's, you know, Herat and Hrothgar's inside, and I'm going to go back to my ship now, or my cliff now, because that's my job. You know, like, basically he's scared to go anywhere near Herat because Grendel, you know, goes there. And so you see that the brave watchman is not brave at all. And you get this juxtaposition or contrast between what a real brave warrior, Beowulf, looks like, as opposed to a warrior who likes to be thought of as brave, but is really scared. You know, Beowulf showed up here, and this watchman tried to intimidate him by shoving a spear in his face and talking a big talk, but Beowulf was not afraid. And what's interesting is these people who try and bully other people, who try to make other people afraid to make themselves seem brave, they're the first ones to be scared. The watchman got intimidated by Beowulf, and he's clearly intimidated by Grendel, and Beowulf is not. So you get this juxtaposition or contrast between warrior types. But that brings us to chapter 6. Beowulf arrives at the mead hall, and he's going to continue there. He meets a guy named Wulfgar in chapter 5. Wulfgar is the lieutenant of King Hrothgar, like his I guess, second in command, if you will. Then Wulfgar went to the door and addressed the waiting seafarers with soldiers' words. My lord, the great king of the Danes commands me to tell you that he knows of your noble birth, and that having come to him from over the open sea, you have come bravely, and you are welcome. Now, go to him as you are, in your armor and helmets, but leave your battle shields here and your spears. Let them lie waiting for the promise your words may make. Now, this is a dangerous moment for Beowulf, too. Like, if you leave your weapons and shields outside and you go inside this hall, you could be ambushed and killed. But he's got to decide whether he's going to trust Hrothgar or not. Footnote. And you'd know this if you were an Anglo-Saxon and knew all the old legends. Beowulf's dad, Edgtho, was a great warrior, and he knew King Hrothgar. So Hrothgar and Beowulf's dad were like friends. Beowulf's dad is now dead. Hrothgar's still alive. But Beowulf's dad, Edgtho, apparently the story goes that Edgtho killed a warrior of a neighboring clan called the Wolfings, and in order to avoid a war between the Geats and the Wolfings, the king of the Geats exiled Beowulf's dad, Edgtho, because he couldn't afford the blood price. And Edgtho ended up in the service of King Hrothgar, you know, living in Herat and fighting for Hrothgar. And he did this for a while, and until Hrothgar felt that he had paid off his debt, and then Hrothgar sent the blood price money to the Wolfings, and Edgtho was able to go back to Geatland because his exile was over. And so on some level, there's a past history between Beowulf, who would have spent a few years as a really young child in Hrothgar's court, and Hrothgar himself. And he feels that he owes it to Hrothgar for helping his dad out to save him. And so there's a background here that as a reader you would know that you don't know at this point because you're from 2020 America. But I think that's going to come out a little bit here, and it helps to have the background information. Beowulf arose with his men around him, ordering a few to remain with the weapons, leading the others quickly along under Herat's steep roof into Hrothgar's presence. Standing on that prince's own hearth, helmeted, the silvery metal of his mail shirt gleaming with a smith's high art, he greeted the Dane's great lord. "Hail, Hrothgar. Higelac is my cousin and my king. The days of my youth have been filled with glory. Now Grendel's name is echoed in our land. Sailors have brought us stories of Herat, the best of all mead halls, deserted and useless." Did I skip something? All right, rewind. He greeted... There's a whole section that totally got skipped there somehow. There we are. No, I guess I didn't. Sorry about that. He greeted the Dane's great lord. I guess that's all that I missed. "Now Grendel's name is echoed in our land. Sailors have brought us stories of Herat, the best of all mead halls, deserted and useless when the moon hangs in the skies, the sun had lit, light and life fleeing together. My people have said, the wisest, most knowing, and best of them, that my duty was to go to the Dane's great king. They have seen my strength for themselves, have watched me rise from the darkness of war, dripping with my enemy's blood. I drove five great giants into chains, chased all of that race from the earth. I swam in the blackness of night, hunting monsters out of the ocean and killing them one by one. Death was my errand and the fate they had earned. Now Grendel and I are called together, and I've come." Pause. Woo! That's some intense stuff. So Beowulf meets King Hrothgar, and he introduces himself. And his introduction is pretty intense. He's like, "I've come to kill your monster," right? But he says that my people sent me because I'm so intense. And he opens up with this boast, this brag, that's one of the best brags in the entire thing, maybe one of the best brags I've ever heard. Beowulf says, quote, "They have seen my strength for themselves, have watched me rise from the darkness of war, dripping with my enemy's blood." Holy smoke. So Beowulf is used to fighting. And when he fights, he wades into battle with his sword and just cuts people down. And at the end of it, out of the darkness, out of all the corpses, Beowulf rises and he's dripping with blood. There's blood dripping all over him. None of it is his. It's entirely his enemy's blood. It's like some twisted Gatorade commercial. Is it in you? You know, or something like that. But it's not enough that he can slaughter mass piles of human enemies. No, we've got to amp that up. "I drove five great giants into chains, chased all that race from the earth." Whoa, okay, so apparently he's defeated five giants and enslaved them, and he's also wiped the giants out of the earth. This is a bad translation. If you go back and you read the original Anglo-Saxon and various other translations, it turns out that he's driven all of that race from his land is a better translation. So it's gotten to the point where giants don't even enter Geatland anymore. They're like, oh, that's Geatland. Beowulf lives there. Better go somewhere else. And he turns around and leaves. Now, of course, this is an interesting connection between Beowulf and a really famous pagan god named Thor, who was also famous for killing giants. So it starts to make you wonder whether, you know, in the original version of this, if Beowulf isn't like a demigod son of Thor and Grendel isn't a demigod son of Loki. I think that would make sense given what maybe the original context of the story was. But anyway, it's not enough that we've established that he's defeated giants. Of course, this establishes his strength, right? Like his superhuman strength. We're seeing that attribute here with the defeat of giants. But then he says, "I swam in the blackness of night hunting monsters out of the ocean and killing them one by one. Death was my errand and the fate they had earned." So, he swims in the ocean in like the North Sea where it's icebergs and freezing and the temperature doesn't affect him. And he does it at night when it's coldest and he just kills sea monsters for fun. So this establishes his unlimited swimming abilities. He's establishing himself as a figure of civilization against nature, somebody who's able to be victorious in situations that a regular person couldn't possibly be victorious. At the end of this speech, he says, "Now Grendel and I are called together," like it's somehow beyond him, like he's answering a calling, "and I've come." So how does he finish this speech off? That's an intense brag. He says, "Grant me then, Lord and protector of this noble place, a single request. I have come so far, O shelterer of warriors and your people's loved friend, that this one favor you should not refuse me, that I alone and with the help of my men may purge all evil from this hall." Pause. So he makes a request of King Hrothgar, and the language here I think is equally important and shows you the intelligence and the clear nature of Beowulf's understanding of the culture. He says, "Grant me, Lord and protector of this noble place." So he's complimenting Hrothgar, he's complimenting Herat, a single request. "I have come so far, O shelterer of warriors and your people's loved friend," more compliments, "that this one favor you should not refuse me." This is a favor, this is a request. "You can help me, Hrothgar, that I alone and with the help of my men may purge all evil from this hall." The idea here is he's not belittling Hrothgar. He's not like, "Hey, old man, I hear you got a monster you can't kill because you're a pansy." No, he says, "Can you do me a favor, Hrothgar, and let me kill your monster?" Which keeps Hrothgar's pride and his honor intact. It makes it sound like Hrothgar is doing him a favor when he's really here to do Hrothgar a favor. So he keeps the old man's honor, and I think that's important. Let's see. "I have heard, too, that the monster's scorn of men is so great that he needs no weapons and fears none. Nor will I. My lord Higelac might think less of me if I let my sword go where my feet were afraid to. If I hid behind some broad linden shield, my hands alone shall fight for me, struggle for life against the monster. God must decide who will be given to death's cold grip." Pause. What? Beowulf's like, "Hey, I'm going to fight this monster without any weapons and without a shield and without armor. You know, he's going to come and I'm going to come and we're just going to fight each other with what God gave us." This makes, you know, like, this is the ultimate brag. I mean, this is arrogance in the extreme. Beowulf's going to fight Grendel barehanded. Well, there's a couple of reasons behind this, and there's a couple of reasons this would be a really big deal to an Anglo-Saxon audience. So, number one, there's this old way of thinking that, you know, like, there were these combats to the death that happened pretty frequently, honor combats, and you would have a champion and you would have a challenger. Generally speaking, the challenger gets to choose the weapon, and then the champion has to fight with those weapons against him to defeat him. In this particular case, Beowulf is offering to be a champion for King Hrothgar. That would make the challenger Grendel coming to King Hrothgar's palace and fighting a battle, and therefore the challenger gets to declare the weapons. Grendel has already declared that he's fighting with bare hands, and so Beowulf is sort of honor-bound by this old matrix, the challenger champion matrix, to fight in the way that Grendel has decided. And so he's upholding Anglo-Saxon values when he decides to fight barehanded. So there's that. But also, you know, like, he's saying, "I don't want an unfair advantage. I want this to be an even fight," which, you know, you wouldn't think that it would be. So I think there's something about honor in that as well. But if you're an Anglo-Saxon, okay, and you're a pagan especially, Beowulf just decides to fight Grendel, this hideous monster, without a weapon in his hand. If you recall, the way that you get to Valhalla is to die with a weapon in your hand. So Beowulf is going to fight this monster without any weapons. He's going to risk going to hell and not being in Valhalla. And you know, that's a pretty big risk for him to take. It's jaw-dropping to an Anglo-Saxon. They'd be like, "Oh my God, now is the author doing this to substantiate God? You don't need to worry about going to Valhalla because you can go to heaven." Maybe there's something to that, because the very next line is, "God must decide who will be given to death's cold grip." So he's invoking God. He's saying, you know, that God will decide the outcome of this battle, not me. And death's cold grip, great personification there. "Grendel's plan, I think, will be what it has been before, to invade this hall and gorge his belly with our bodies, if he can. If he can. And I think if my time will have come, there'll be nothing to mourn over, no corpse to prepare for its grave. Grendel will carry our bloody flesh to the moors, crunch on our bones, and smear torn scraps of our skin on the walls of his den. No, I expect no Danes will fret about sewing our shrouds if he wins. And if death does take me, send the hammered mail of my armor to Higelac. Return the inheritance I had from Hrethel and he from Wayland. Fate will unwind as it must. Okay, so Beowulf here says, you know, Grendel's plan is pretty simple. He's just going to come and murder us. You know, like this is the classic and maybe the original haunted house story. How many haunted house stories have you read where people go and they have to stay in a house through the whole night and survive? That's Beowulf's plan. I'm going to stay here in this haunted house and demon's going to come for me and I'm going to fight him. And if he kills me, he kills me. If he kills all of us, he kills all of us. He'll take us back to the moors, scrap little or smear bits of our skin on the wall and munch us down. Now, can you imagine being one of Beowulf's 14 guys? Like, you know that all these Danes have died. You know that everybody's freaking terrified. And here's your boss like, I'm going to fight him without a weapon. Huh. You know, and if he kills us, he kills us. So what? I would be like, what? But that's okay. You know, so he essentially says, you know, don't worry about it. I'm not going to put you out at all. You won't have to bury me. You won't have to worry about anything. I'll just be dead. But if I do die, because I'm not going to wear my armor and use my sword, if I do die, please send that stuff back to my king, Higelac. So again, loyalty to a king. He gave them to me, and they need to go back to him. But at the end of this, he says, fate will unwind as it must, which is, of course, an allusion to the three fates, those creepy witches with their strings unwinding. And so, you know, it's interesting that in line 440 up here, he invokes God. God must decide who will be given to death's grip. But in line 455, 15 lines later, he says, fate will unwind as it must. It's almost an ambivalence. Which one of these things do you believe in? Whatever the case, he's willing to accept what's going to happen, and he's not afraid of it at all. Hrothgar replied, king of the, or protector of the Danes. So we hear King Hrothgar's voice for the first time. Beowulf, you've come to us in friendship, and because of the reception your father found at our court, Edstho had begun a bitter feud, killing Hathlaf, a wolfing warrior. Your father's countrymen were afraid of war if he returned to his home, and they turned him away. Then he traveled across the curving waves to the land of the Danes. I was new to the throne then. A young man ruling this wide kingdom and its golden city. Hrgar, my older brother, a far better man than I, had died, and dying made me second among Halfdane's sons, first in this nation. I bought the end of Edstho's quarrel, sent an ancient treasure through the ocean's furrows to the Wolfings. Your father swore he'd keep that peace. My tongue grows heavy in my heart when I try to tell you what Grendel has brought us. The damage he's done here in this hall. You see for yourself how much smaller our ranks have become, and you can guess what we've lost to his terror. Surely the Lord Almighty could stop this madness, smother his lust. How many times have my men, glowing with courage drawn from too many cups of ale, sworn to stay after dark and stem that horror with a sweep of their swords, and then in the morning, this mead hall glittering with the new light would be drenched with blood, the benches stained red, the floors all wet from that fiend's savage assault, and my soldiers will be fewer still, death taking more and more. So a lot of his soldiers get drunk and they're like, I'm gonna kill Grendel! And then like the next morning there's like blood everywhere and they're gone. And this has happened I don't know how many times. So it gives you more intensity to what Beowulf is getting ready to do. But to table, Beowulf, a banquet in your honor. Let us toast your victories and talk of the future. Then Hrothgar's men gave places to the Geats, yielded benches to the brave visitors, and led them to the feast. The keeper of the mead came carrying the carved flasks and poured that bright sweetness. A poet sang from time to time in a clear, pure voice. Danes and visiting Geats celebrated as one, drank, and rejoiced. So they decide to have a party before, you know, Beowulf fights Grendel and theoretically dies fighting him. So that's the end of our chapters for today. I'm gonna close this off. But clearly Beowulf has set himself up to face Grendel man on man without weapons at night. Seems pretty arrogant. Does Beowulf have what it takes? We'll find out next time. We'll be right back.